And Jesus absolutely cracks me up. I have to laugh. Just I just get the biggest kick out of his teachings, and it's just like truly appreciate them. It's like you're in a desert, and there's all these people like hawking. You're thirsty. You're real thirsty, and there's all these people saying, "Here's water. Here's water. Drink." And it's just pitchers of water that they're offering you. All these different pitchers. Look at this pitcher. Look at this one. Isn't this pitcher of water, you know, look wonderful, refreshing? And you just say, "Wow, that doesn't satisfy me." And here's Jesus with a glass of water. You know, he says, "Here, try this." And you just say, "Ah, oh, that's funny." It's the difference is just funny. Good Lord. So I've been slogging through spiritual teaching, just say, what is it? You know, I don't know what the world, what, why? The teaching is so odd. Then I turn to Journey Beyond Words and Jesus' chapter on time, for instance, and just like boom, 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 boom. It's just like, yes, it's that easy. Wow. Is night and day. It is absolutely night and day. And how do, you know, I'm not going to even bother trying to explain how that. It's like drinking an actual glass of water instead of looking at a pitcher of water. I recommend it, but probably people will not take the recommendation, knowing, living here in this world, knowing that people do not generally take recommendations. Understandable. So we'll just do what we can do. I certainly drink the water and share that with others, and maybe this watching these videos helps a few in the world, and they will help others, you see. That's the whole how it goes. But it's amazing to compare the teachings. I've been really bogged down in searching through a lot of different teachings, just trying to say, is anybody out there saying anything remotely like what I'm saying? And then I come across Jesus' words is like kaboom. It's like, wow, this is just exactly, you know, what I'm saying. It's just incredible. Well, not incredible, amazing, wonderful, wonderful. I don't like the word incredible because not credible, you know. No, it's very credible. It's super credible. Super credible. So welcome to the video. And it's okay to laugh at times. I just find it funny. I just find his style is so refreshing. It's funny. It's so direct. There's just no beating around the bush. No trying to. It's just brings the hammer down. Boom, 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 boom. And so beautifully and compassionately. And yet it's so simple. It's right there. You just say, yeah, okay, that's it. So I love the teaching of Jesus. It's my favorite teaching of all, for sure, for sure. So it's not a idolatry thing with Jesus at all. It's the teachings are so great. You know, I just say, well, I love these teachings. So it's you know, that's content. That's content. He just dismisses everything. Form, you know, this world. Form. Boom, 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 boom. No. God, don't need it. Don't need it. So he says, if you believe at all that you cannot be perfectly happy right now, right? Then that's delusion. There's absolutely no circumstance whatsoever that prevents us from being perfectly happy right now. None whatsoever. And I could read, you know, from a Journey Beyond Words, but the Holy Spirit says, no, don't do that, don't do that. If somebody wants to read it, let them read it. Let them read it. But in comparing that with other teachings, which I've read so many of, it's just night and day. It is truly night and day. This is just so liberating. It's just, he talks about how if you actually experience or just get a glimpse that you're not a body, and no one is bodies, and nobody's bound by appearances at all. Just a glimpse will save you thousands of years of misery. Well, I just got a glimpse yesterday in church. I just said, I saw it. I said, wow, we're all free. Nobody's bound by any appearance of age, of youth, of any appearance whatsoever in terms of the body we're talking about. And you can include that to all appearances, but we can talk about the body and say we are not bound by our body in the slightest bit. It's simply an appearance. We're not bound by form or appearance whatsoever. And he talks about not valuing form, not valuing appearances, meaning I don't need this appearance in order to be free. Now we need these appearances in order to pretend that we're not free. That's true. That's what we need them for. But we certainly don't need them in order to know that we're free, do we? But this saving thousands of years, it causes some stress and strain. I didn't sleep at all last night. Because, you know, wow, a bird just came down right here. On the ground. It's always interesting when a bird suddenly comes down out of the sky and lights right in front of you on the ground. I always find that meaning something very positive. So what am I going to do with those thousands of years that I just saved in suffering? It's like, right? It's like, wow. I mean, it's better to just let go of time altogether, don't you think? Instead of saying, well, I saved 1,000 years, 1,000 more. If you're still thinking of in terms of time, you say, wow, how in the world can I adjust then to, you know, it's very shocking. So the best thing is just to, you know, get over time altogether. Okay, now there are all sorts of, like, three birds are hopping around here. That's good. Why bother with time at all? That's the question I'm starting to ask myself now. It's too difficult, actually, to keep making these huge leaps to save yourself all this time, and then, but where do you fit in then? I'm thinking it's better just to see through time and just continue to see through it, and then just fit in with that, so you don't have to keep making all these adjustments. Now here comes the cat after the birds. See? Always some threat here, you know, in this world, isn't it? Place of identifying threat. So yeah, that seems to be the best strategy. So say, sure, I accept a non-dual abidance right here, right now. It's the only home there is. And I'm totally welcome there. Totally welcome there. Let's keep in mind that non-dual abidance is our only home. It's the only home there is. See, it's the only home there is. Everything else is a dream of homelessness. Everything else is a dream of homelessness. So, non-dual abidance is my one and only home. It's the only home there is. Non-dual abidance is the only home there is. And I'm completely welcome there. How can we not be welcome in the only home there is? We're perfectly suited for our home. We're perfectly happy there. So of course we've been dreaming of being homeless. And when we decide to wake up from that dream, I mean, our home is just going to welcome us with open arms, say, you're so, so welcome here. The reason why we do not wake up is we feel that we're not going to be welcome. That's one reason. The other is that we're also ashamed at leaving any place so wonderful. Like, how could I possibly have ever left this place that is so stupid? You know, it's just impossibly stupid. Well, it's whimsical. It's impetuous. It's very impetuous. You might look at it that way. Just very, very impetuous to do that. And quite frankly, we are quite afraid of impetuosity, which is why we think that abiding in non-dual abidance is impetuous. We want to do things slowly. That's part of our continuity fear, knowing that our impetuousness is what got us into this trouble in the first place. So when we abide in non-dual, the absolute, abide in the non-dual absolute, we can say, wow, leaving this, trying to leave this, is just incredibly whimsically impetuous, you know, and I'm not going to do that. Just utterly impetuous, totally impetuous. Okay, that's one part of it. The other is I'm not going to be welcome there. Oh, we'll be welcome. Imagine if there's this like brand new country club. It's just gorgeous and golf course, a couple golf courses around it, lodging, a hotel, country club, resort. Okay, let's say just an incredible resort. Let's say just super, super high class and wonderful and beautiful, and it's all brand new. And the whole staff is there waiting for what? For you, for the members, those who are members of this resort. Well, who are the members? You are. I am. We all are, actually. So they're just waiting for us to recognize that we are members and come in, and we come in, and they, you know, concierge is there, and let me take your bags, your golf gloves, and just. Service is like totally impeccable. They thank you so much for coming. You know, they're just delighted. They went to all this trouble to make this incredible resort, and you know, nobody's showing up. So you show up there, and it's like you're just like totally honored, you know, to have shown up. They're just completely delighted. The whole staff and the whole place is just delighted because it's there for you. If you don't come, then there's no purpose for it. It's not fulfilling its purpose. So, of course, you'd be like, you'd be absolutely honored to the ultimate to show up. So we'll be completely welcome. Welcome beyond anything we can even imagine how welcome we are to actually show up to the place that has been prepared for us. In the ultimate sense, non-dual abidance. In another sense, Jesus called it the state of the holy instant, abiding in the holy instant. That's another way of putting it. And perhaps in a more mundane way, you might say that there is a realm, a death-free realm, such a beautiful realm. It's just like an immaculate realm, and we're welcome there. We're all welcome there. Why doesn't anyone show up there? Because, one, they're afraid they won't be welcome. Two, they're afraid they'll be thinking, I'm so stupid. Why'd I ever leave here? Why'd I ever leave anything that even remotely doesn't resemble this? You know, this is a reflection of reality. How could I possibly have done that? You know, that recrimination, self-recriminations. And continuity fear. Oh, how can I go from place of total threat here to place of no threat? So, I mean, just like, you just think like it'd be overwhelming, you know, overwhelming for you. So that too, you know, you have this whole constellation. It's all the continuity fear issue, sort of, wrapped into one, we call it, wrapped into one. And certainly, you can feel recrimination, self-recrimination. This has to be worked on. Wow. How could I have been so, how could I have ever left this place? It's just, isn't that, I mean, you come home after a long odyssey of just hellish odyssey, and you see this beautiful home you have, and it's just, you say, why did I ever leave? That is just, I can't believe, why did I do that? You know, well, impetuosity. An abundance of adventurousness that spilled over into impetuosity. And in terms of being welcome, of course, the place will just have to be like overflowing with gratitude that you're there. It's the prodigal son, the story of the prodigal son in the Bible, I believe, that where the one that comes home after a long journey in hell, an exile, self-imposed exile, comes home. And the, you know, huge parties are thrown, and the welcome mat is rolled out. And the one that never left home said, you know, how come I don't have these parties? And it was told, you know, that, look, the one that is coming home, they're going to feel like, hey, maybe I'm not welcome here anymore because I left, right? We're thinking, hey, you know, we left this place, so maybe this place doesn't want us back. We must be thinking, hey, they must not have not liked this place. They must have left it for somewhere better. So, they may think, I'm like, wow, if you why should we welcome you back if you feel that you this place is just some second-rate place? I mean, you know, we're worried about that. Because, of course, we left claiming, well, we're going to find someplace way better than this. We feel ashamed of how could we have been so foolish, you know. But again, it's impetuous, very impetuous. So, it welcomed the prodigal son back. All these parties and stuff are designed to ease this feeling of like self-recrimination, shame, feeling that they're not really welcome, might not be welcome back after bad-mouthing the place, you know. You know, we've been bad-mouthing reality so much. Like, I don't want that. Are you kidding? I gotta find it. The ways are way better, you know. And gallows humor kind of thing. And on the gallows, you know, say, who needs life, you know? The gallows is way better. That's gallows humor, you know. We don't see. So, we have all these concerns, a constellation of concerns, and what's driving all this is just this basic continuity. If you're like, can I really reassimilate? Can I really reassimilate? What has to happen is for those who take who risk it and decide, you know, I think I believe I can reassimilate. I can be reassimilated here. They do reassimilate, and then they reassure others. So you can do it too. Yeah, it's easier than you think. You're totally welcome. You're totally honored. You're totally invited to stay there forever. In fact, it is your home. In fact, it's the only home there is. And you forgive yourself for being so impetuous and leaving and being so impetuous that you tried to badmouth the place. It was all spiritual pride. It was all impetuous spiritual pride. And then you gradually get used to the amazing beauty and the peace and the serenity. The calm, how everything is, you realize it's made of light. In fact, it's not made of light, it is light. Everything is light. All forms are lit. you ask a plant to do a dance, it'll do a dance. If you ask it to send out beautiful sound vibrations, it'll send out sound vibrations. I mean, everything is livingly responsive to you. And I just was imagining today just some of the beauty of it. And it's just it's endless beauty. Whatever you can imagine is beautiful. And more, God is harmonizing with you. And it's just, you just go from wonder to wonder to wonder to wonder. Like, wow, this is just so exquisite. 360 degrees of exquisiteness in all directions extending to infinity. And there's a feeling of worthiness too. You say, we're not worthy. We're just human beings. We're supposed to work. No, we're not human beings. We're spirit. That's the whole point. We're getting reacquainted with the fact we're spirit. All this beauty and sumptuousness and glory would not be given to human beings at all. The flesh, why? What does flesh ever do to deserve that? Nothing. So, of course, we are spirit. So if you take it that way, then you can accept it. Whereas if you say, no, I'm just a human being, I'm just a, you know, a development of an ape, and then of course you're going to say, well, I can't accept this. I don't feel worthy. I mean, you hear about some metaphysics talk about how you can actually manifest a diamond. You know, if you really work spiritually, and just attain the highest attainment, you can actually manifest a diamond. Isn't that incredible? And we think, wow, this is a joke. This is a joke. We can literally manifest 360 degrees extending to infinity of absolute jewel-like radiantly beauty that just, is alive. We can manifest a river of diamonds, an ocean of diamonds, a universe of diamonds, like that. What are we talking about, trying to manifest a diamond, here in this world? That is so ridiculous. Thus, for people who think they're human beings, the human organism, you have so much power, human organism, you can actually figure out a way to, if you really, spend your whole life, you might be able to materialize a little diamond. Wow. That's the story of somebody who spent their whole life learning how to, anti-gravity or something, so they're able to walk. They walked across this river, and Buddha was on the other side, and he said, oh, wow. Hi, Buddha. Buddha said, hey, how are you? He said, I noticed you're able to, did anti-gravity and went across the river. And he said, yeah. Buddha said, how long did it take you to learn how to do that? He said, well, I spent my whole life in a cave. I've been meditating to gain this power, this city. And Buddha said, look, for like a real couple of pieces of change, there's a ferry boat right there. You just take the ferry across the river, and you could have spent your whole life being truly liberated from the illusion of time and space and worked on the continuity problem instead. So, and it's like we're spending our whole lives trying to figure out how to manifest a diamond, like a 2-carat diamond, and we think like we'll be great magicians, then everybody will like be in awe of us, oh my God. This is something that I really want to do. I'll be rich if I can just manifest a diamond. Oh, how incredible, It's like a parlor trick a magician would do, and everybody is, ooh, ah. What a joke that is. Spend your time instead liberating yourself from the idea of valuing appearances, the idea that you're a body. Liberate yourself from any idea that you're a body. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me to be. Whatever we desire, it is. That's our power. Whatever we desire for our experience to be, it is. It is. It is. That's our power. We're spirit. So we desire this this beautiful landscape, 360 degrees. Massive arcades of glorious gold palm trees made of gold, dripping fruit like diamonds, you know, dates just kind of slowly dripping, it's just oozing diamonds, you know, yeah, this massive grove, walking through an arcade of these stately palm trees, beautiful colored birds flying through, a hum in the background, the atmosphere's perfect, piece of cake, whatever we desire is, whatever we desire experience is, that is the truth. This belief in time, which was process, his moments are like, is total delusion. It is simply an arbitrary insistence on our part to believe in this. There's no basis for time whatsoever in reality. None. Whatever you desire to experience is, that's reality. Whatever we desire to experience is. What I like to do in imagining this is imagine playing a round of golf, and each hole is different, and going from one hole to the other, you go through an adventure, and like one hole is just like, it's just like whatever you can imagine, all these gorgeous rock formations, like plateau, like marble, just this incredible beauty, and then water flowing between cracks and all of this, creating a beautiful reflection and sheen, you know, and then just go on and on of just this, you know, the richness of experiencing. Wherever you look, your creativity creates this gorgeous panorama, 360 degrees. And as long as you want to experience it, it is for you. It is for you. There's no end to this isness. Whatever we desire is. Whatever we desire to experience is. That's what Jesus says. That's the truth. That's the truth. And as we get reacquainted with our functioning, of course the glory gets more and more glorious beyond anything we can even imagine here. But we need to crawl before we can walk, and walk before we can run. Here in this world, we're not even crawling. We're like more like comatose, actually. We're like a completely comatose, paralyzed. It's like we're paralyzed and we're kind of like moving a hand like this, you know. That's all we can do. Not even crawling. So let's at least start crawling. I used to practice golf courses, going to different golf courses I've never been before. And just, you get first hole and you don't know. Oh, it's beautiful. Then you go to the next one. Oh, wow, it's different. That's beautiful. There's another one. Wow, it's beautiful. Everyone's like different. It's just like, you say, wow, that is so nice. And it's kind of an experience, a way of practicing, actually, in this world. I found that to be so. Whereas you get this idea of you can just be flowing through a landscape, you know, like in a little electric car, so to speak. And just driving, and it's just, you don't have to go fast, and you just go slow. I remember going in the desert, like, I like to go in the desert when it's like 115 degrees or 14 or whatever. Nobody's there. See, this is why, nobody's on the golf course. I go out in the middle of the day. Nobody's there. I have the entire golf course to myself. Then what I do is I just go really slow, really slow. And I just stop. If I see something that's beautiful, I just stop. I just sit there and just take it in. So intense. And then after several, you know, after a while, you just say, okay. And you go on to the next, you know, drive a little more. And if you see something beautiful, you don't worry about playing golf fast. You just look at the plants. Just look at the beauty. Just look at the vibe. Feel the vibe of the whole place. And just go real slow in this electric car. That's, for me, that's rehearsal for the higher realms, for sure, where there's no time pressure whatsoever, where you got to get somewhere, you know. So, and if there's somebody who wants to play what I do, if someone's in a hurry, I just pull off to the side and let them play through. I say, play through. So you can be out there for like 8 hours or something if you want to. Just taking it real slow. Tee off at like 11 o'clock and come in at 7 o'clock or something. Of course, the heat is so bad, you don't want to stay out too long. But, you know, you get the idea. You feel free to just sit there. Just sit there and just look. That's what I do. That's what I have done. So that's why I love going to the desert in the blazing heat, because nobody's there. Now, ordinarily, you go in the wintertime, and it's like completely packed, and you have to go, and you can't really do that, unfortunately. Yeah. I didn't make it this summer. I just, no funds, no ability to go, which has really, really bothered me. I always wanted to take people down to the desert and do this, you know, as a group, and practice for the higher realms. It's tremendous practice. I always wanted to have a private golf course and use it to practice. Really, that was my dream in life, is to have a higher, a private course, just gorgeous private course. And invite people who are ready, who are getting ready to go into the higher realms. And they could practice to going around like this. Just take all day, and just soak it in. Now, people do this on hikes, right? They do it on hikes. As you get older, some people are not so adjusted to the rigors of hiking. Some are. People have done this in the Himalayas for ages. And they simply walk a lot. You hear about the spiritual masters in the Himalayas, sure. There'll be a group with a spiritual master, and they'll just walk through the Himalayas, and they'll just stop whenever they want to stop. And they just, you know, take in the spaciousness of the landscape, the beauty, the spaciousness of the landscape. I mean, that's very awesome. Now, in today's more sedentary world, where we're such, you know, weaklings by comparison, you know, for me, it's not practical. But golf courses can be used for something very similar. They have all sorts of water features. Those are beautiful plants, you know, immaculate green. You know, it's a very powerful experience, actually, I found. Most powerful. But the Himalayas, too, that can be incredibly powerful. Like the paintings of Nicholas Rourke going through the Himalayas. Oh, my God. You know, you just see that. Let's just stop here. And let's just soak this in. You're looking at these incredible vistas. Incredible vistas. People go like to Yosemite, they go up in the mountains all the time for these vistas or the spaciousness. And so these are ways of rehearsing. Now, I don't know why my rehearsal has dropped off the way that it has. I'd like to get back to it, but I don't know how, you know, feasible that is, really. I don't know what's up with my situation at all in the world, really. That's why I'm wondering what's going to happen, really, in this world right now. I can't figure it out. I just cannot really figure it out so well unless there's something is really going to happen here. And there could be some exodus. You know, it seems that way. Like, when I ask, what is my role here in this world, I get no answer whatsoever. I cannot get any answer of what my role is in this world. No answer. I say, wow, that's crazy. I don't have a clue. I don't have a clue what to do here. Maybe that's because I'm not going to be here. You know, that's one way of looking at it. Going to be somewhere else. Maybe a lot of us are going to be somewhere else. A lot of us. And you cannot have hate in your heart. Go to the higher realms. You have to have forgiveness in your heart. You have to realize everybody can forgive themselves. Nobody is bound to any appearance whatsoever. Everybody is spirit. All is spirit. It's easy to get into hate here in this world. There's so much hate right now going on in the world. I was just reading some forum. Wow, the hatred is just so intense here. They're just off the charts. Vilification of people. And God, I wanted to say something. Good Lord, people, you know, you you're missing. Of course, they hate Jesus, they hate religion, they hate everything except their own self-righteousness. But that won't get you into the higher realms at all. You have to realize everybody's here out of spiritual pride and a continuity fear. They're fearful, and they're here to try to identify threat. You're not bound. How can you hate others when you realize you're not bound by anything at all? So what's the basis for hate? It must be you. You're insisting on being bound. You know, that's actually hating the other person, actually. Saying that you are binding me. You know, you're the source that is binding me. That's not true at all. We're binding ourselves entirely. We're binding ourselves entirely to valuing form. Valuing form as if a certain form is necessary for us to be what we are. Being, form arises in being, but being is not dependent on form. It's not being says, wow, without this particular form, I wouldn't exist. Being would not be. Now, it's true that the play of appearance, we might put it, from where we're at, from our perspective, there is the formless play also. That's the reality, actually. But from our perspective, it seems like that being is completed by appearances, right? Okay, fine. But what I mean, it doesn't need any specific appearances. Just appearances appearing. Just appearing. The appearance. Appearingness. Appearingness. It's not saying, well, I have favors that this specific appearance has to appear, otherwise I'm not going to be fulfilled or anything like that. No, it's not like that. No preferences. Being doesn't have any preferences at all. Doesn't have preferences one way or the other. It delights in the arising and the falling, so to speak. There's a delight, some sort of delight from our perspective. We're not talking about just pure essence and the ultimate. That's beyond our capacity. We just go into ideas and intellectualism instead of actual experiencing. That's the problem. If you try to teach too high, you get stuck into spiritual intellectualism. That's not good. That's not good. We want experiencing. We want experiencing. That's why I say I feel like the most spiritual things I've ever done is go out on those golf courses in the middle of summer. People think, crazy, why are you going out there? So, wow. I said, just wow. For me, it was just like mind-blowing. I'm out there in the middle of the fairway, and there's the golf bus. Look at that tree. Let me drive over there. I just leave the golf ball. You just go and drive by a river flowing through a creek or something, and sit in the shade, and everything, the shadows are moving. It's just like the crickets, or all these cicadas are making noise. And you say, well, I just want to stay here for a while. You just sit there like for 5 minutes or whatever. Just soaking it in. And then you go, oh, where's my ball? Oh, it's over there. Okay, now I'll go hit the ball, and then go drive off somewhere else. And I even drive over to other fairways, There's nobody on the course. You can drive anywhere you want to drive, actually. So the higher realm is like this golf course where you can go and drive wherever you want to drive. You can hit your ball wherever you want to hit your ball, as a matter of fact. Wherever you want a green to be, there's the green. You see? And if you don't want a green, then it's just beautiful fairways. You just hit your ball on and on and on through just this incredible beauty. You want to see this gorgeous circle of waterfalls streaming, and with just most delightful delight imaginable in the air. Just all these butterflies, millions of butterflies. It just goes on and on what we can imagine. Actually, the play of light is just so exquisite. And you can imagine a beautiful green there, and you're just, you go out in the green and you putt and you're just standing there. And you're just watching all this water play. But then you go on to the next hole. You say, well, I don't have to value this because I can always go back to it at any moment I want to. So let's say hit the ball down another fairway and I'm moving around. And I say, you know what? I want to experience the exact same green and waterfall. And you hit, and there it is. And you hit your ball on the green and you go and you stand there. There's the same experience all over again. And you can do this endlessly if you want to. Resolving our continuity fear. Again, formlessness is beyond the scope of what we can even experience. So there's no point in really talking much about it at all. That gets into spiritual intellectualism, which we try our best to avoid. Avoid, okay. You could have these two groves of palm trees on either side, and between them this gorgeous water feature and living light. You could have the air full of these soft, floaty, you know, puffy orbs, butterflies, and the palm trees could be made of incredible goldenness with marbling throughout them, and the palm fronds could be, you know, just dripping diamonds. Slowly dripping into the water, the still water, and every diamond hits the water, and the ripples are like ripples of diamonds or something, and on and on, there's no end to the beauty that you can desire. Say, this is what I want to be experiencing, and it is. And as you watch this pool, beautiful pool, you could say, I want to be experiencing this pool expanding into an ocean. And then you find yourself on an island, little island, green, and all around is this endless ocean. With beautiful clouds, massive clouds around on 360 degrees. And out of those clouds, this soft rain of what could be falling just into the ocean. And there's just drip, drip, drop, drop in the ocean, plump, plump, plump. And the whole thing's like a symphony, you know. And all these little drops of water in the ocean is playing this incredible music for you. And the music extends on infinitely in all directions. And then you have this little island green, this level, almost level of the ocean. It begins to rise up. And then you find yourself on it turns into a mountain, and you're on the mountaintop. And there's this, you know, whole big island that slopes down to the ocean. And you have this vantage point, you look out over the whole ocean. And on and on and on. Then you can see the actual water rising up from the ocean. There's rain going up. It doesn't have to go down. Rain going up, all these golden rays of light coming up from the ocean, you know, and it just seamlessly, whatever you want to imagine, this is what is. And if you want, you can get on a water slide from the top, very top of this very, very top of this mountain. You imagine you want this beautiful waterway where you're going to just slowly float down to this ocean. And as you float along, the banks of the river, the banks of this waterway are just laden with the luscious foliage and beautiful, most beautiful flowers and fragrances and hum and all sorts of manner, beautiful expressions in the air of colorful this and that. And I just saw this seed pod that kind of floats along, the white one that's all puffy like cotton, sort of. The whole air is just full of beautiful things floating, and you're floating through the river, and the river is jewel-like, and you just, you know, you're going down to slowly towards the ocean, no hurry whatsoever. And maybe you don't even, you feel like, you know what, I don't even need to reach the ocean. I'm going to reach, you know, somewhere else or something. And then, so you come across that. You see, whatever you desire is. Whatever you desire is. You could decide that you're floating, and you decide you're going to go down this massive downward motion through Earth. and all these layers and levels of soil and sediment and crystals, and you go down into this utterly incredible crystalline experience with, you know, just infinite expansion of crystals in all directions of all different shapes and sizes and colors and radiance. And you go down into this, and you're in the middle of this glow, crystal glow, and then the whole glow becomes transparent, and you're in the middle of this massive planet globe. It's all crystalline, and then you see light streaming out through all the crystals, or streaming in through all the crystals, and you're just in the middle experiencing all this play of these rays of light of every kind of frequency, so to speak, living light just streaming through the crystals, and as it hits each crystal, it changes and shimmers, and you know, and you're just in the middle of this. Yeah. And then you desire this experiencing to just all the crystals turn into a sky-like, you can go on and on. whatever you desire, and you get used to this. You have to practice it, of just this flowingness. Maybe one of those golden rays coming through the crystals, you now actually step upon this ray of light, and this ray of light takes you through the crystals, and you're actually moving through like fluid, like water. Now the crystals are like water crystals, and you're just flowing through the water crystals, like liquid crystals, and you're just moving through this, feeling all the, you know, infinite facetedness of all this. On this golden ray of light, and this golden ray of light then takes you up into a firmament, and you look down, and you see a million stars beneath you. All these stars are sending infinite amounts of love to all other stars. And up from these stars is rising up these beautiful forms of love, all the stars, and you're simply, so again, whatever it is, whatever you desire to experience, it is. That is our power, because we are created as an extension of the Creator, of God. So we are creators. Whatever we desire to experience is. Now we have desired to create the experience of form and time. But the only thing we cannot do is change what we are. So we cannot make time real, and we cannot make valuing a form real. Okay. We cannot bind ourselves to appearance. We cannot. We're always free. We're always free. That's how we're created. We're not created to be bound to time, to form, to process. Whatever we desire to experience is. But we're free, always free, every moment, to experience anything else, any other experience we could possibly imagine. That very instant, let's say we're in the middle of this glow, crystal glow, this massive crystal glow, and we desire to experience ourselves sitting on a beach, sandy beach. Instantly, that's our experiencing. Instantly. In other words, no matter how beautiful this sitting in the middle of this crystalline globe is, we're not bound at all by any appearance, by any experiencing. We're not bound by it. And so we practice that. We practice shifting. No matter how beautiful, we think this is wonderful, but I'm going to practice. I want to be on a beach, and I'm sitting in this sand, and there's all these miniature crystals. And in fact, there's all these shells. There's all these crystals form all these gorgeous tiny little shells, and they're all miniature shells, and I'm just sitting on this beach. And then the water is playing, and the water comes through and is playing with all these little shells, and the little shells are tinkling gills. They make a little sound, and you hear the water as it plays with it, with all these little shells is producing this beautiful, soft sound of music for you. Most exquisite. You realize the entire beach is perfectly in harmony, playing this gorgeous composition, free-flowing composition. And it's the most enchanting thing you've ever heard. You know, you're just sitting on this beach, just listening to it. Just soaking it in. This is what we're created. This is how we're created to function. This is how we're created to function. You might say we're pure awareness. When we speak of awareness, we mean the capacity to experience. We're pure experiencers. Pure experiencers. I've never understood the term awareness, because that's just the intellectual term, spiritual intellectual term. But if you put it in this context, that you're on this beach hearing the water play with these tiny shells, and these shells are conducting this unbelievably complex and beautiful symphony for you with billions of little tones, each one of them unique to, you know, all woven into this celestial harmony. Well, what is it that's experiencing? The pure experiencer, that which was created to delight in experiencing. And then you see this mountain of shells. So the beach just turns into this huge mountain, completely made of like coral shells, beautiful, just with every facet, and then light, you know, streaming through it, emitting this light that is all tinted to each, every possible hue. And there's all these wonderful scents and sounds. This mountain is emitting this tremendous hum, this beautiful hymn of glory. And then you, it's simple. You desire it and it is. And we're co-creating with God. So God is harmonizing everything, harmonizing and adding to it. But you see, this is all effortless. There's the living light is doing it. Here in this world of form, let's say you're like someone who has a nice house, you want to redecorate. You say, I want to make, get this feeling of like reality, you know. Oh, I want to change this, I want to change, I want to redecorate, I want to repaint, I want to do the interior. It requires massive manpower and labor, doesn't it, to do all that, and money. And so you get these very rich people who do that, can do it. And, you know, it takes a lot of time and tremendous effort. And, you know, redo this. This floor, I'm tired of this floor. I want to put a different marble floor. Okay, well, it's incredible all the effort to find the marble quarry, to cut it, to finish it, to transport it, to store it, to showcase it, to sell it, to bring it out there, to install it. You know, it's just on and on and on and on and on. All for people who are like desperately needing the work to survive here, to serve the wealthy people who can afford to do this here, constant redecorating. And of course people who are not so wealthy can redecorate in other ways too. But this is like being paralyzed. It's kind of like saying we desire to be paralyzed, but we still want to have, you know, want to kind of, what kind of fullness of expression can we have while we're trying to be paralyzed? The thing is that we end up using other people to do this, you see. Whereas in reality, the living light is providing all this for us. That's how it's supposed to be. We're not supposed to be forcing other other people, pressuring other people, you know, into doing this. Now, sometimes people enjoy that, you know, and like to participate, like in an orchestra. Say, I like to play this instrument. I want to play it with a bunch of other people so we can make this, you know, song. That's just a little way of, you know, you can look at it that way. But this is crude beyond any possible explanation of how crude it is, actually. When we have this belief in form, bodies, and worlds, and process, which is time and space, we are essentially not being creative at all, really. Not really being creative at all. But while we're here, we can at least rehearse. Rehearse to work on the continuity problem. Absolutely, we can. But it's probably several ways. You can do it in your mind, like we're doing right here. And also, you can do it on various ways, like out hiking or on a golf course, like I mentioned. Some people just driving, you know, just driving. Sunday driving, we used to do that all the time. It's just Sunday drive, just get in the car and just drive through beautiful neighborhoods and just, it's just a constant flow of different yards, different, you know, it's like that. But all the effort it took for everybody to make those houses and yards, I know firsthand how that's brutal effort, you know. Somebody cut down all those trees, those lumberjacks, all right? Somebody hauled them to the mill. Somebody milled all those. Somebody stacked all those. Somebody then put them all on a truck. Some truck driver drove every bit of that lumber to some lumber yard near you. Somebody took it off the truck, stacked the lumber yard. Somebody came in and picked up that lumber. Somebody, you know, and then came in and cut all that lumber. Somebody, you know, nailed it all. And they have the blueprint. Somebody has to have the blueprint that, you know, it goes on and on and on and on and on. The incredible effort just to build one house. It's just unbelievable amount involved there. Time and effort, etc. This does not really remind us of reality. What this really does is helps us forget about reality. But what I find, this world, the little tiny crumbs of creativity here, is not so much to remember reality, but to forget it. And it's kind of like we're spitting on reality and say, look how difficult it is to be creative. That, you know, that's terrible. We shouldn't have to do that. As if this world and form was reality. So this world is, this is really a place where people come to forget about reality and how reality really functions. That is the truth. And they can say, wow, you see what a pain all that is, going to all that work. My God, you want a new roof, you want a new tile roof. Oh my God, so difficult to put a roof on, are you kidding? And then after the roof's on, you know, you don't say, well, you know what, I want the slate, I want something arranged a little differently, whatever you kind of roof you have. The pattern's not, yeah, I like the pattern, I want to have changed the whole pattern. Can we do that? No way, only the most eccentric, you know, billionaires can do anything remotely close to that. And even then, it takes an incredible long time. Now, I know these, I have been around very wealthy people with their incredible estates, and, you know, they try to do it, but it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. It's really saying, look how ridiculous creativity is. Let's forget all about it. It must have been a dream, you know. We're trying, we're searching for oblivion. We're searching to locate threat, you know, to our locate threat so that we can say that there, that we can locate in total chaos, we can locate the threat. Total chaos arises when we decide we want to be separate from reality. So we're really here because of separation, and we're really here to badmouth true creativity. We really are. I've seen it firsthand. I don't care how beautiful a tile shop is with all these different gorgeous patterns. Just the effort to do all of this is just horrible. And the money. I mean, who can, how do you manage to be competitive enough to get the money to do this, and how hard you have to work for it, and what a strain. In reality, there's absolutely zero strain to any creativity. No strain, no time involved, no process involved, no other involved in terms of somebody needing someone needing to do that. Now you co-create. You co-create with many. Effortless. It's all effortless. They're not working for you. In other words, you say, I want that coral mountain. They say, okay, let's go query the coral and we'll spend like 50 years on building this mountain for you. Nobody's a slave. Nobody's a wage slave at all. Nobody's a slave. There's no slavery at all in reality. Everybody's completely free. And you're free to cooperate if you want. You know, let's try putting our desires together, what we want to experience, and let's just blend it, let God come in and harmonize it, and let's see what that's like. And then that might be like way better, you know. the intricacy of it, you know. I have this shell beach of all these crystalline little shells, billions of them, so each one exquisitely different than the other, and the water coming in and softly moving everything and creating this lullaby. It's incredible, beautiful lullaby. And someone else has also a desire to experiencing that may be different than that. But then God blends it all together, so to speak. And so not only do I have that, I have this other, you know, expressive, beautiful creativity. Both. And then someone else brings some more, and someone else more and more. So we have all of that going. You know, and ultimately, it's we experiencing the creativity of all spirit and God simultaneously being creative. Ultimately, that is reality. We're experiencing all of it at the same moment. That's how glorious reality actually is. But we first have to get reacquainted with it. So that's, you know, don't think that seems overwhelming to us, right? So that turns into spiritual intellectualism. So let's just work on the very, you know, simple basics here. Very simple basics. So, I might have said, when I was younger, I'd say, well, that's nice, but I want it to be different. You know, in reality, we can make it different like that. And the people say, well, that's nice imagination, but you can't do that. This is reality here. You have to go through all this process to get that. I say, no, you just desire it to be the way you are, and it is. Of course, it doesn't seem like that happens here, does it? And so they think you're nuts. But what really I'm saying is I'm reminding them of reality. This is the place that's nuts. This is the place designed to forget about reality. And of course, since we are naturally creative, we have so much experiencing of this effortless flowing of creative isness, experiencing whatever we desire to experience is, that somehow we have to try and forget that. So we have to bring the creative component into this world in some way, but only to say, you see how difficult it is? you see the troubles you have? You see it isn't what you thought it is, you know, because we're pretending to be bound by time and space and process here, and form, and valuing. So we're really teaching ourselves not to be creative again, and to, of course we can't. We can never lose our love for reality, but we can certainly push ourselves down, seemingly go into a deep coma like sleep. But I don't like doing anything here. It's ridiculous. All that happens is you get frustrated and you start hating creativity. Because in order to get any sort of beauty here at all, you know, you have to go to such work, and it's still so utterly dead. And you just say, why do I even want to bother? I don't want to bother. Why the heck should I even bother? It's ridiculous. It's just dead. It's just a dead image. Reality is 360 degrees. Living, flowing, vibrant, living light. Presenting, experiencing, right now, right here, right now. Always. It's seamless. It is absolutely seamless. Some people love to fly. Pilots are, you know, love to get up there and just, you know, fly through the landscape and turn here and turn there, like helicopter flights in Hawaii through the canyons. And you get that feeling like you can just change, you know, change whatever you want to see. You just tilt the plane and there. So that gives you like a faint, you know, at least echo of memory. But it also makes you feel like, wow, this is really dangerous. It's very threatening. It's difficult. You know, you kind of say, wow, maybe I don't want to do that anymore. So again, I say this planet, and the creativity on this planet, is designed to get us to try and give up creativity and forswear it. Because we think that it's that creativity that's bringing about this chaos, endless chaos, when we try to define, objectify reality. We want to be great in reality, we try to objectify it. We try to feel that it's threatened, that we separated, the oneness has been ruined. But we can't see where has the oneness been lost. I mean, it's endless chaos is what we see. So we feel that the creativity of reality is somehow a threat to us. And we want to get rid of this. So this world certainly, that's why people turn into here and come in this world, they become very cynical, very bitter, very hateful, very upset. Thinking everyone is preventing them from being happy. The rich people are preventing me from being happy. You know, go on rants about how evil this world is in terms of everybody oppressing you and keep, you know, all that stuff. Because they're just there to remember. They're like feeling like, wow, I just can't express. I can't have the experiencing I want to have here. This is, you know, and they think, well, this is it. This is my home. How can I, you know. That's the big mistake. You think this is our home, and you think, how can we get our home to be perfect like reality is, you know? There's no chance of that, really. Not in the way we're viewing our home here at all. No chance. And to say otherwise is just to go into spiritual intellectualism, which is not beneficial at all, actually. So of course people get bitter here. I mean, I've been bitter. We all get bitter at times. You say, I hate this place. It's absolutely terrible. You know, of course it is. Of course it is. It's beyond that. It's really trying to dispirit us. We come here and we get profoundly dispirited. And the notion, people are begging, like, please give us just a crumb of creativity here. But again, the ones who try to do that, they become extremely dispirited, actually, trying to be creative here. To say, wow, I just can't express anything remotely like it is. So you should say no. You know, people say, give me something creative. You say no. No. You repent. You need to repent. You don't need something creative in this world. That's like damning with faint praise. It's like damning reality with very faint praise. Very faint praise. It's way better to repent. You got to repent. And you have to recognize your error, your mistake, and what the purpose of this world is for. And you have to say, I repented. I don't have this problem anymore of a world. I don't have this problem anymore. And return. You must return to get reacquainted with true creativity. You had no choice but to do that. The idea that you can somehow sit here with a big record collection. And I've seen people with this. I saw somebody, it was like unbelievable. He had this big room. It was this hidden room. And all four walls, from floor to ceiling, were completely filled with vinyl records. Thousands upon thousands upon thousands. And more and more and more vinyl records. Pristine condition, you know. And he had this incredibly sophisticated turntable. And speakers, everything was just like the best. And he just, he'd say somebody you like, he'd pull out, here's a vinyl, put it on, and he'd sit there. That was just like paradise. He's trying to, you know, get this feeling. People do it for music, like collecting it. Just think of all the effort it took for everybody to make those records. The songwriter, the hellish lives that songwriters go through, desperately trying to get someone to interest in their song. The tough life of musicians, brutal life of musicians, the producers, the engineers, you know, the actual people who make the vinyl, people who make the microphones. It is a colossal enterprise to make these records, actually. Distribution, just everything. Everything. The musicians themselves. So that guy can sit there in his room with these vinyl records. It takes almost immeasurable effort of lives and struggles. And even that is like damning reality with totally faint praise. Damning reality with totally faint praise. It's better not to do that at all. Don't be this collector, you know, who thinks you can collect all this beauty, you know. Forget it. I've done that before. I've done it with clothes. I've done it with a number, you know, various things. I collected all these incredible clothes with all this, the hippie clothes of the 60s and 70s, with all the embroidery, you know, beautiful embroidery of flowers and stuff. It's just like the most gorgeous clothing you've ever seen. It was just so beautiful, but damning with faint praise. Utterly damning with faint praise. And I thought I could put on an opera with all these different costumes. Opera is a way of, again, trying to get some sense of creativity. You have the full orchestra, you have the great singers, you have all the incredible costumes, you have the incredible backdrops, okay? Again, this is a desperate desire to get some sense of creativity, you know? Again, it is damning with faint praise. Just a colossal effort to put this on. So we have to renounce this damning with faint praise and this is not the way. Entertainment is not the way here. It is not. You only end up getting bitter and disillusioned. Because, just like I said from what we were going through, that imagery of sitting on this pristine beach that actually stretches on, the beach stretches on to infinity, you know, just like, as far as you can see, it's just gloriously clear and shimmering in clarity. And there's trillions of gorgeous crystalline shells, trillions, all there, and the water coming in, and with infinite intelligence, moving each crystalline shell in perfect harmony to produce these trillions of tones that is weaving into the celestial harmony. And then you have the clouds, a massive cloud bank over the ocean. And the clouds are emitting rain drops of gold, of silver, or silverine drops, crystalline silverine drops, with the light going through them, creating this beautiful shimmer. And all of the raindrops are perfectly coordinated with all the music of all these trillions of shells that are arising. And all of this is happening with complete intelligence and effortlessness, without any struggle, strain, blood, sweat, and tears. Any need for a body at all. There's no need for a body at all. Just pure awareness desires to experience this, and it is. If you want to say that there's a body sitting there in the sand, fine. That's perfectly fine. That too is part of the appearance. So, and this is just like that. So how can you remotely equate that with like all the hell of putting on an opera, you know, just the blood, sweat, and tears, and stress, and, you know, just straining to do it right, and everybody in the audience is straining to get it, you know, and it's just, are you kidding me, you know? It is damning with faint praise, truly damning with faint praise. You know, we need to get this, we need to get it. You know, I used to be involved in the whole entertainment scene, for sure, and I burned myself out so terribly, trying to produce something that can even be a faintest. No, it's futile. It is completely futile. It's the most futile enterprise of all. Entertainment is the most futile enterprise there is. Give it up. You're only giving a very wrong impression, damning with faint praise, for sure. It is better to spread the gospel of salvation, the gospel of repentance, the gospel of the continuity fear, the gospel of reality, you know, spread that through the world. That is what really does wonders, which is why, for instance, the Christianity has long tried to ban entertainment and all that stuff. Not because they're bad people or anything. It's because they know that's not the way. That's damning with faint praise, and that's actually getting you to turn away from the true creativity. Absolutely, entertainment is. That's its purpose, really. It's really its purpose. You think, yeah, this is creativity. You're in some Oktoberfest beer hall, and then some oompa band, you know, is playing, and everybody's drinking, dancing. So, wow, this is great. This is real creativity right here. And everyone's in a drunken stupor afterwards, and the musicians are so tired. It's like, oh, man, it's such an effort. And it's like, oh, God, I just didn't earn hardly anything. You know, how do I survive? And people underneath are saying, you know what? This creativity is just horrible. I hate it. You know, I hate creativity. I just want oblivion. I just want to be able to recognize threat so clearly that I can have oblivion or something, right? This is not the way. So Christianity has always tried to put severe restrictions on entertainment at all levels. Theater, plays, operas, music, you name it. Entertainment across the board, restricted, and it should be, absolutely should be restricted. The world would be infinitely better off if entertainment was heavily restricted, because then all this damning with faint praise would not be taking place. All this tremendous attempt to damn creativity, you know, and turn away from it would not be taking place so severely. And the people who have time to listen to the gospel and hear the good news, the incredible great good news. We are not bodies. We've never been bodies. We are not bound to form. We have never been bound. We can never be bound to form. No matter what arises, we are never bound by it. And then we can start evaporating that continuity fear and start to, like just right now, I'm able to imagine all this, you know, just like spontaneously imagine this whole scenario of just incredible beauty. And that's just the faintest, little tiny, you know, this. The glory just goes on forever. That's reality. And so we're certainly not going to remember reality by, you know, playing on a piano. No matter how nice you play, forget it. And you know that too, you know, as an ex-piano player and musician, number of instruments, you know that no matter how great you play, the people are still feeling like, you know what, you just damn something with faint praise. You know, if you're sensitive, they may say, oh, that's so wonderful. You're such an incredible player. What they're really saying is, you know, it's like, this is so unfulfilling to me, really, actually. But thank you, because I'm trying to forget true creativity. And so you did such a wonderful job helping me forget true creativity. You did such a wonderful job damning with faint praise. That's what they're really saying. That's what they're really saying. All these, you know, bands playing, the people going crazy. Saying, thank you. Wow, you're so incredible. You're so great at damning creativity with faint praise. I just love that so much, because I want to completely separate from God and be greater than God, but I have this horrible problem of total chaos, you know. And I want to be able to find some way to be able to completely detach from that. Completely detach from that. And clearly identify how it is that we manage to threaten reality without any creativity interfering with it. You see, we feel that this creativity interferes with our ability to identify threat, so we can supposedly identify where is it that we manage to destroy reality, destroy oneness. And all we're seeing is this total chaos. We can't find it. And so, but our creativity is pulling us back to dropping this desire to be greater than God, right? So we really want to try and turn away from creativity. That's why we're here in this world, both to identify threat and to turn away from creativity entirely. Damn it all reality, damn it with faint praise. Damn experiencing with faint praise here. So as always, I try to put content in here that just like stunning. I mean, I didn't plan this video at all. The Holy Spirit just brought it out of me somehow. It's like, well, I'm stunned too. It's like, wow, this is really great content. And I really like this content. I love this content. This is fantastic. It's amazing. holy cow, puts the whole world in a completely different perspective, doesn't it? What we're doing here. And you can see why religious restrictions are not stupid. They're not stupid at all. A lot of religious restrictions are actually very designed by those who know reality, how it really is, and know how to bring us back to it. We were at church yesterday, and we have this singer who's a very good singer. And the singer was singing this song up in front of the whole congregation when it's supposed to be done in a very low-key, humble way. We're not trying to emphasize entertainment here. But she's such a great singer that it just, you know, sounds like some type of a performance. And she enjoys, you know, singing great too. And after she sang, someone in the audience said, "Hey, you have such a beautiful voice." He said it out real loud. And she, like, shocked, stunned her. She says, "Oh, thank you." And so what he was pointing out, hey, this is a performance. You're damning reality with faint praise here, you know, by trying to sound really great. You see that? It's amazing. I said, yeah. Yeah, one more, please. Okay. And, you know, some people may think, no, I want entertainment. I want all this entertainment, you know. Ah. You know, when you get it and you just feel like, that's not it. That's not even remotely it. When you have even the experience of the higher realms of formless, not being valuing form, and like the vision of oneness. Okay. So, it's so stale. Entertainment is so stale. And yet people think, if I don't have that, you know, I have nothing. That's not true. You have a spiritual path. Spiritual path is way more interesting than entertainment. Way more compelling, because you know you are going towards glory. And we're all attracted to glory, actually. We're all attracted to our one and only home, which is the glory of whatever we desire to experience is. Instantly is. And if we want to experience that a trillion times it instantly is. Now, we're sitting on that beach with all the trillions of little crystalline shells, each one so different. And we decide, you know what, shells, you're going to do a little parade right in front of me. So now we're sitting on a bench and there's a little promenade along the beach. And all of the shells are walking along, are floating along, and they're all moving and emitting beautiful sounds. And you just watch these trillions of shells going by. In a beautiful parade, endless parade. And each shell as it goes past you suddenly unfolds like a flower and turns into a beautiful flower and floats off down the promenade, you see. It's just endless, incredible experiencing, effortless. Not attached, because you want the parade again? Here it is again. You want the order of the shells different in the parade? It's all ordered differently. You want clouds to rain down crystalline shells? To fill up an entire ocean? And as they hit the water, they turn into liquid crystalline. Then the clouds will rain down these crystalline shells. If you want them to rain down for a trillion times, it'll do it a trillion times, all completely effortless. No threat whatsoever. And we need to talk about this right where we're here. So why are we talking about entertainment? You know, why are people interested in entertainment when we're able to actually visualize this? I mean, I'm able to visualize this as I'm talking to some extent. At least feel, you know, feel that this is possible and just a general sense of this. Not trying to get it, because you can't get it intellectually, so to speak. You know, don't try to force trying to get it. Think, okay, I can get this experience totally here, this way. We have to truly be more spiritualized, as it were. The continuity fear has to really evaporate more and more. But we can do this, you see? And we can realize, wow, this is something that pure awareness, where pure awareness and spirit and desiring for experiencing, and anything we desire to experience is. And we are the perfect awareness that enables all this to be experienced. We are all in all as it were, both the experience and the experiencer, and just all one. It's all one. If we want every one of those trillion of crystalline shells, trillions of them, to turn into a tiny little sprout, okay? And all these sprouts, each one with a different beautiful pattern and pattern, all are growing up, like that. And then they all can, you know, weave a tapestry, a beautiful tapestry, a living tapestry of greenery for you. So you can just weave endless tapestries, living tapestries. And then you have this incredible, the sky is full of this incredible tapestry of living greenery. And then all of it suddenly rains down as little crystal shells again. And you can play with this endlessly if you want. I mean, and then you have all turn of little sprouts of a different type, vines going up. And another tapestry, different tapestry, all come down as little shells again. You know, just there's endless creativity, actually. This is just the tiniest, infinitesimal tip of you know, the infinite iceberg of unlimited creativity. Whatever we desire to experience is. This world is an attempt to turn our backs on that. It is an attempt to turn our backs on that. So we should not indulge that attempt, because for sure, it's going to make us feel as if we're bound to this hellhole here. And that's going to feel like it's driving you crazy eventually. You keep indulging in entertainment, you're going to really be in trouble at some point. I guarantee it. Been there, done that. That is for sure. The whole thing, I gotta go to a concert, I gotta pay a ticket, I gotta drive in, I gotta get parking, I have to go and deal with all this crowd, I have to deal, you know, it just makes it feel like such a terrible experience compared to the effortlessness of our true creativity. And it sours you, it's souring you on creativity, thinking, wow, creativity's horrible, really. It sours you on it, eventually. I know people take a lot of drugs to try it and try. So I got to keep doing it, but that's because they're really soured on it. It doesn't feel right. It doesn't feel right. Creativity in this world does not feel right in the slightest bit. It feels like something's drastically wrong with creativity, drastically wrong with ourselves, with our pure awareness, with all of realities and things. Seems drastically wrong, immeasurably, terribly wrong here. That's because we're trying to turn our back and trying to get us to, you know, we're trying to forsake true creativity, forsake it. All this fake stuff here. Just things, toys. You know, you gotta go in the store, you gotta buy it, bring it home, play it, then it breaks, put it in a closet, you gotta store it. There's no storage problem in reality, right? Whatever you want to experience, it appears in infinite spaciousness. And we want to experience something else arises. It's not like, say, where do I store that beach with all those shells? You know, I need to, where can I put that? You know, in some museum. It's always instantly available to you as a manifestation. No storage problem, no ticket problem, no money problem. Pity the poor, the rich people in this world. I'm telling you, the most fortunate people are the poor people here who can't afford entertainment. Those who are not so well here, you know, who just I can't do anything. You know, I just sit here and think about study truth, actually, Rich people can afford all sorts of vacations, all sorts of entertainments. They spend their lives doing this, doing this, doing this, doing this, doing this, souring themselves on reality. That leads them down, 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 down. Often the people, those who truly are on the path of return, sometimes they're very poor. They don't have many opportunities in life. You know, they certainly don't attend, you know, they can't afford going out for, you know, dinner and entertainment and dancing and shows and all concerts and you know, all this stuff. They can't afford any things, and their house is kind of barren. They're poor. But they're studying the truth. They're studying the true teachings. You know, just studying. I'm really focusing on this. I'm trying to repent. They're very repentant, very humble. Repent. Those are the blessed ones. You know, those are the ones who are no longer trying to sour themselves on reality by all this frivolity of the world, this gloss and tinseltown, you know. I mean, these like dinner shows, those used to be really big and probably will come back. You go out to dinner and there's all this show during the dinner, you know, and after dinner and the cocktails and the drinks and the dancing and the drugs, you know, and just like trying to, oh, and you think, wow, what a life, you know, the high life, leading the high life. There's all these magazines about showing you what the high life is supposed to be like, and the fashion and the clothes, and you think, man, this is just like, this is so unbelievably cool and creative. What a great lifestyle I've got. What you're really doing is you're souring yourself by damning with faint praise. You're souring yourself towards reality by doing that. That's why I stay away from that stuff. And whenever I had any taste of any of that stuff, I said, this is souring me on creativity, real creativity. This is making me feel depressed and blah. This is horrible. This is horrible. Forget it. Even now, I can listen to the best song I can possibly find, you know. YouTube's got so many songs, and you can find what you really like, and you listen to it and say, ah, man, that's just, it's like death. It's like death. It doesn't give me the flavor of reality at all. Best song imaginable is still just like, wow, that is so utterly flat. The best of this world is just utter flatness, actually. So Jesus said, don't lay up your treasures in this world. Don't seek your treasures in this world. That is for sure. It is designed to sour you on reality, to turn your back on your functioning of reality, so that all we do is try to identify threat, which, of course, this whole world is all conflictual threat. Everything is threatened by everything in this in materiality form, in nature, so that we can then somehow identify how it is, where we manage to threaten reality, and therefore be greater than reality, instead of viewing it as total chaos. That's what we're trying to do in this world, by coming here in this world. So you have to be smart, wise, informed, which is what the various religions have tried to do. There's certainly been some. And those who have been enlightened in all religious traditions, there certainly have been those who are enlightened for sure. And they know how bad it is to indulge in this world. Because the indulgence of this world sours you, damning with faint praise, and you get turned off more and more and more, and you become more and more materialistic, more and more materialistic, brutish. Eventually, you become much animalistic. You start wanting to imitate animals. See, these people with all these piercings and surgeries, they're trying, I had this one man who tried to become like a tiger, or a lion, a tiger. Had tattoo stripes on his whole face, had his face cleaned into looked like a cat face, you know, and everything. He transformed himself, you know, it's just like frantic to become animalistic. And that becomes even more just horrifying, you know, to the spirits. Need to repent, need to pay attention to those who are wise enough to warn you, admonish you about this world. You should be admonished about this world. You should be admonished It is absolutely necessary to be admonished in this world. And admonishment is disappearing. It's becoming extinct in this world. You might hurt somebody's feelings. You know, I mean, it's all this PC, spiritual PC nonsense, you know, is trying to evaporate all admonition in this world. Worst thing the Catholic Church ever did was Vatican II, abolishing the list of all the stuff that you could not watch, all the entertainments that you were, you know, that was sinful to partake of this. But that's the whole church purpose is admonishment here. If you're not admonishing those you're trying to help about this world, what are you doing? What are you doing? There's the admonishments now are so watered down, it's ridiculous. But they used to have this you know, this whole list. They had people checking the books, the movies, all entertainment, and saying this is should not be watched. It's harmful to your spiritual progress. Exactly right. Very harmful, as a matter of fact. Damning with faint praise is the trick of this world. Okay? So you may think, oh boy, I'm really, you know, getting all this great groovy entertainment, but inside your spirit's saying, oh, this is horrible. This is just terrible. How I can never be happier. I might as well just go into oblivion. You know, we want our spirit to go into our functioning, spiritual functioning, just become oblivious to it, actually. So to give up admonition, admonishing in this world is throwing in the towel. It's throwing in the towel, essentially. Now, there are some good aspects of Vatican II, etc. But that doing away with I forget the name of that, the office, that did that. But doing away with that was a drastic mistake. Because they're trying to keep attracting people, and they think that people will be turned off if you admonish them about entertainment. But then you go out of the religion business then. If you can't admonish, you shouldn't even be in the religion business at all. Should not be in business at all. Now I just say don't watch any movie. That's very simple. Don't watch any. Don't go to any entertainment. If you can, don't listen to any music if you can possibly handle that. And most people can. I try not to. But all entertainment, no. Now, of course, you might have trouble with that, but that should be a goal. You should at least understand the God admonition and why it's there. Because the more you stay away from that, the more you start remembering that souring that you have, it starts to disappear, and you start to say, wow, I really am welcome in my true home, one true home. There's only one home, and I'm welcome there. I'm very welcome there. I'm honored there. All creativity, living light is just waiting for me. Please start creating like you used to create. Please, you know. We're just thirsty for it, you know. To just say, yeah, this is the glory I want to see. And phew, here it is. All creation is thirsty for us to create the way that we were created. To function the way we were created to function. So the welcome mat is infinite for us. We're infinitely cherished, infinitely cherished. We say, thank you, thank you, thank you. You're back, you're back. The real band is back together again. You know, the real band of pure awareness, of living light, of love, of co-creation with God, of harmony. The band is back. You see, you gotta put that band back together. Forget about these bands in the world. You're putting the real band back together. And so you know these renunciates, they're not listening to music. They're not watching art. You know, they're not watching plays and theater and stuff like that. No, they're not. They're not. They're also celibate. That's another thing, another whole area. You know, of damning with faint praise, for sure. Damning with faint praise, for sure. Sensuality, get rid of it. Don't indulge in it. Don't indulge in it. You're only damning with faint praise and souring yourself, trying to sour yourself to oblivion, actually. It leads towards oblivion, attempted oblivion. You will feel like, wow, I'm just in this feeling of oblivion. This state of oblivion is horrible. Been there, done that, you know. It's horrible. this is the way the world's leading right now, into this hideous depression of a feeling of like, I just feel like almost oblivion. I feel so soured. You know, it's horrible. This is what the television, this is what the popular modern culture is leading towards. Hollywood is leading directly towards that. Directly towards that. Hideous. You see why so many entertainers just have hideous lives, so many drugs, so many problems, so much unfulfillment, you know, commit suicide ultimately. Because they're leading us nature. Try to be oblivious to our true functioning. They're leading us into oblivion, so they themselves end up feeling very much in oblivion. I feel like I just gotta commit suicide. That's how they feel, for sure. And I've tried warning them. I've told my whole life, hey, I'm admonishing and warning. Does anyone listen? Maybe a few. Maybe a fortunate few. But I'd like more to listen, for sure. Because admonishment is the greatest love and compassion in this world. You know, if you have enough love for people to admonish them, that they're on the wrong path. You know, that's love in action. That's compassion right there. And thank God there is still some admonishment taking place in the world. I remember the Dalai Lama said no to drugs. He said drugs are poison. Don't use them. I respect that, you see. He's admonishing. All right? I'm not trying to deify the Dalai Lama because I wish there's some things I wish he'd admonish more, you know? But that's fine. Okay, he's doing what he's doing. Much appreciated. Much appreciated. And to all those of you who do admonish, who are admonished, say no to drugs, say no to sensuality, say no to entertainment, say no to the sleaze of modern culture, say no to Hollywood, say no to all this. Thank you very much. Thank you. Greatly appreciated. You don't know how much appreciated it is. It's just tremendous gratitude for all of that. For all those who have stood up throughout the ages, say no. This is a trick. We're trying to turn ourselves away to be oblivious of our true functioning through damning with faint praise. This is a trick. This world is a trick. This whole world is a deception. Absolutely. And so, and for all those who say no to sensuality, you know, no to entertainment, all that stuff, keep admonishing, keep admonishing. Say this is. They call it the devil's work. It is the devil's work. It is the work, you know, of trying to turn away and become oblivious to our true functioning. It absolutely is, 100%. Now, the Holy Spirit can turn us, does turn us back in the right direction. Understands we have a continuity fear. So there can be some intelligent use, like I talked about going out on the golf course and the flow of that, or Sunday driving. There are certain ways that you can start to remove the sourness, so to speak. Okay, but you know, this has to be under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. It really does. And you have to be very consciously aware that this does not substitute for repentance at all. It does not substitute for hearing the gospel, the good news. It does not substitute for taking the admonitions to heart. It does not substitute for clarity at all. It doesn't substitute for it. It's an adjunct to it, okay? It goes along with it. But be aware that in no way, you know, does it even hardly touch upon, you know, I mean, our true functioning. I think I found a way driving the golf cart wherever I wanted to, turning in any direction I wanted to, and just flowing through this, you know, this beautiful area, just flowing through it, the flowers and the rivers and the trees, and just being able to flow in any direction I wanted to. At any time, it's all beautiful. See, I found it's even better than hiking a lot of ways. Like hiking, usually you're on a trail. Okay. Now when I hike, I just go off trail. I go anywhere, but it gets nasty, it gets dangerous. On a golf course, there's no feeling of threat. 360 degrees you turn around is beautiful in every direction. And if you can just go driving in any direction you want to, and turn here, turn here, turn here. I always ought to go this way. Oh, this is nice. And it's just all peaceful. It's all beautiful. It's all serene. I found that a pretty interesting way, you know. But that too is flat. That too is flat. But there's a faint echo there. There's a faint echo there. Glass blowers, you know, people who are blowing glass and playing with this, you know, there might be a faint echo there, right? So there can be faint echoes in very sublime type of functioning. But be very careful. It should be almost effortless. Okay, what you're doing. It should be effortless to you. Now, you know, you get some great jazz like player, you know, in some way, and they seem to be just doing it effortless. Well, it's still the effort of someone else, isn't it? Like out on that golf course, it's not the effort of anyone else. I'm completely responsible, almost effortlessly, for what I'm seeing, what I'm viewing, what I'm experiencing, right? Whereas that jazz musician, believe me, it takes a lot of nerve, a lot of effort. A lot of times they're on drugs to be able to get the creativity. You know, it is tough. It is really tough. But you don't want to have somebody, you know, the effort, the toughness should not be there. Should not be there. Sometimes people walk through a very beautiful area. You know, and walking on a beach or something is something you can do. You can stop whenever you want, and you can go whenever you want. You know, people do that. The reason I do that, it does give a faint, you know, can give a faint echo. So there are ways where you can get a faint echo. But that does not, so it's not supplant the spiritual teaching, spiritual truth, contemplation, listening, full stop listening, repentant listening. Absorbing the teaching, meditation, the affirmations, the declarations, the whole process of evaporating the continuity fear, that has to be your career here in this world. It has to be. Otherwise, you're going to turn and go towards souring and turn towards oblivion. No question about it. And when you make that attempt at oblivion, which most of us in come this world will do, have done, or will do. I certainly did it. You end up with, again, just in this. You realize total chaos, and you can't locate any threat, and you still feel desire to be creative, and it doesn't work. It doesn't work. It absolutely doesn't work. This world, its purpose does not work. It will not work for you. It will never work for you. So you have to give a different purpose to it, which is the spiritual path. You have to take this path of gradually evaporating the continuity problem and listening to admonitions and following the admonitions and not being rebellious. You must tame your rebellious spirit, which is spiritual pride, which is continuity fear. I know people seem to hate admonitions now in this world. That's a sign of how much spiritual pride there is in the world. I love admonitions, just love it. Someone said, you shouldn't, do not do this, you know, this. Thank you, let me consider this, you know, like that. And now more and more, whatever I come across, I realize, wow, that's damning with faint praise. That is too, and that is too. Oh my gosh, you know, everything in this world is designed to damn with faint praise. Holy cow. And it may be that golf, I did enough of it, you know, and something else needs to come about somehow. And we'll see what that is. But by all means, take admonitions to heart. It's not just some silly, I don't know what the complaints about it are, really. The people complain, they just rationalize it like crazy. It's just spiritual pride, it's foolishness, it's ignorance on their part. Nobody should tell me what to do. Well, when you're in this sort of problem, the continuity problem, you do need help. You got a severe problem. So listening to admonitions is the way. Will always be the way here. The idea that somehow we're entering some new age where, hey, we can just all do whatever we want to do and just entertainment everywhere and 24/7, let's just the whole world be like Las Vegas and everybody be happy. And this is the most ridiculous notion ever of how that'll just, basically we're saying, hey, we're entering into oblivion, folks. No, we're not. Your spirit can never be oblivious to its functioning, never oblivious to its desire to function as it was created to function. And so you're just headed towards severe depression, manic depressiveness, and then ultimately severe depression, for sure. Or, you know, suicidal wars through a manic phase, you know, global manic phase, or a global depressive phase. Manic phase first, and then depressive phase after that. Going right into that. So we should be admonished. And maybe this manic phase is coming up very soon, which maybe we need an exodus to some other dwelling place. You know, this place, this world here, who wants to go through a manic depressive, global manic depressive episode here, which the world is very likely to go into, the way that it's going, for sure. No. Fortunate are the ones that are sitting in a little monastic cell, carefully contemplating this, carefully burning off the continuity fear, carefully allowing clarity to arise from within, from the Holy Spirit, from within, and seeing, oh, this is what the world's about. Oh, this is why I came here. Oh, this is my spiritual pride. Oh, I repent from this. And wow, now I see a different way. Wow. And going through this whole, you know, evaporation situation, those are the fortunate ones. Those are the fortunate ones. Because very soon they'll be functioning again in glory like they were created to function. Very soon they will. And wow, they're just like, the glory is just, you know, you can't even conceive of it, how exquisite it all is. And it goes more and more and more and more, forever and forever and forever. So we just need to get into this, you know, get into it as well. We just need to, we're just crawling into it here. And yet, you know, be forgiving of ourselves, but careful too, careful. This whole society is so messed up that it's pretty difficult to take a hard line on everything. But do as much, best you can. Do as best you can. All right, and take it to heart. Just take all this teaching to heart, so to speak. Full stop it. Don't let the rationalization of the continuity fear and spiritual plight and rebelliousness and the desire to damn with fame priest. Don't let any of that take a hold. You know, don't let it take root in what we're talking about here. Take it to heart and leave it there. You know, full stop right there in the full presence of what's said. Just abide in the full presence of what is said and leave it at that. Just leave it as holistically. Just leave it as a holistic presence. Just let it be there just like that. All right, and we will see what's the next breakthrough. Well, this video itself has been an incredible breakthrough, actually. Fantastic breakthrough. And we'll see what's next. Exactly right. Okay, very great. That's it.